evidence that he was not actually functioning as president. I think the pithy way to make that point is,
thank you very much.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Please welcome Dean of the George Washington University Law School, Blake D. Morant.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and it is indeed a pleasure to welcome you all to this special event that's being hosted by the George Washington University Law School. We are very pleased to host the National Asian Pacific American Bar Association, as we fondly call NAPABA, for this timely program on diversity and inclusion in the legal profession, featuring U.S. Supreme Court Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg, and being moderated by her former law clerk, Goodwin Liu, Associate Justice of the Supreme Court of California. The George Washington University Law School always seeks opportunities to bring contemporary programming to the community here, and especially to our students. And this particular program stands out among all of those that we have given so far. Of course, we all know the legendary Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg, but I've got to tell you, of all of the things about her that makes her so special and that you're here tonight, one of the things that I tell our students all the time, the true definition of a great professional is not only the person that has distinguished herself as an absolute stellar individual in the law, but it's also the individual who gives of herself to the community. And certainly Justice Ginsburg has exemplified that in many ways throughout her illustrious career. My wife, Paulette, and I have had a chance to really know the justice over the last, I would say, 9 years. When I was dean of the Wake Forest Law School, she had the occasion to teach in that law school's Venice program. I never knew that another feature that Justice Ginsburg had was patience and bravery, because one of my duties as dean of the law school was to drive her on the narrow streets of Italy from Venice to Verona to see her favorite opera. It was a stick shift vehicle. She was both brave and very charitable. But in all seriousness, ladies and gentlemen, we are very, very pleased to bring this program to you. We are grateful to NAPABA and all of its members that are here with us today. I'm very, very honored to be able to welcome you all to this program. And without further ado, it gives me a great deal of pleasure to invite to the podium the president of NAPABA, Pankit Doshi. Let's give him a warm round of applause.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you all for joining us for this very special conversation with two trailblazers, Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg and Justice Goodwin Liu. My name is Pankit Doshi, and I'm a partner at McDermott, Will & Emery in San Francisco, where I practice labor and employment law. I'm particularly excited to stand before you as the current president of the National Asian Pacific American Bar Association, what we call NAPABA. NAPABA represents the interests of over 50,000 Asian Pacific American judges, legal professionals, law students, and others from around the country. Our members, including over 80 affiliated local bar associations, work in nonprofits, law firms, companies, and courtrooms. We are very proud of all that our members have accomplished over the past 30 years and what we'll continue to achieve because we're NAPABA. I encourage all of you to become active in NAPABA, your local diverse bar associations, and other groups to advance inclusion in the legal profession and to realize the promise of civil rights. Now, thank you to our hosts at the George Washington University Law School and the many luminaries and future lawyers in the audience. On behalf of NAPABA, I'd like to extend a special thank you and greeting to GW Law Dean Blake Morant, GW President Thomas LeBlanc, Judge David Tatel of the D.C. Circuit, Judge Robert Wilkins of the D.C. Circuit, Judge Raymond Chen of the Federal Circuit, and Justice Ginsburg's current and former law clerks. Today, we continue an important conversation about diversity and breaking barriers. NAPABA had an incredible year promoting diversity in the legal profession, including with our efforts advocating for diversity in the judiciary, our most successful Capitol Hill Lobby Day in history, increased efforts to facilitate the civic engagement of our members, and the strides we've made in leadership training to support diversity at the highest levels of the profession. With all of the energy and enthusiasm from this past year, it's only fitting that we cap off this year, our 30th year anniversary, with this special event. We come together here because we recognize our diversity as a strength. We all have something to offer because of our unique and individual experiences. We have a commitment to our community, and we want to meaningfully tackle the barriers and biases in the law. Through this evening's discussion, we hope you will be inspired by how far we've come, but really armed with the knowledge of opening doors and to keep them open for those who follow behind us. So it is my great honor now to introduce the Honorable Ruth Bader Ginsburg, Associate Justice of the United States Supreme Court. Entering her 25th year on the court, Justice Ginsburg has seen and experienced the legal profession's evolution. Her groundbreaking work for women's rights and her commitment to inclusion are why many of us are sitting in this room today. But while we've all read about Justice Ginsburg's legal opinions, many of you may have also seen the critically acclaimed recent RBG documentary that was released. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, we have the notorious RBG in the house. Now, while this larger-than-life character is a bit tongue-in-cheek, as the justice says in her documentary, she has a lot in common with the notorious B.I.G. You'll have to wait to hear why shortly. But more so than the humor, Justice Ginsburg's own experience of being discriminated against, overcoming that discrimination, and ascending to the highest levels of the legal profession is truly an inspiration for us all. Joining her in this discussion is her former law clerk, the Honorable Goodwin Liu, Associate Justice of the California Supreme Court. NAPABA's dear friend, Justice Liu, continues to promote strong Asian Pacific American voices in the legal profession and is a role model on the bench. His groundbreaking report, conducted with NAPABA and Yale Law School, was entitled A Portrait of Asian Americans in the Law, and it highlighted the shocking statistics regarding barriers to advancement in the legal profession. Indeed, we continue to wait for the first ever Asian Pacific American U.S. Supreme Court Justice, who may be sitting in this room today. Without further ado, Justice Ginsburg and Justice Liu, thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Pankit, and thank you, Dean Morant, for the wonderful introductions, and thank you, Justice Ginsburg, for spending some of your evening with us here. So you just celebrated your 25th anniversary on the Supreme Court. Congratulations. Over that time, people have called you a superhero, an icon, a rock star, a great dissenter. You have a huge fan base. There's an opera about you and Justice Scalia. There are notorious RBG t-shirts. There are RBG emojis. And even tattoos. That's real love right there. And now you're a movie star on top of that. The documentary about you was a big hit at Sundance and went on to become one of the highest grossing independent films of this year. So let me just start by asking you how this movie came to your attention and the process of making the movie.
How did RBG begin?
Yes.
Well, first I think I should explain what I have in common with the notorious BRB. There's something quite important. We were both born and bred in Brooklyn, New York. So how did it all start? It all started with a film called Makers. It was on PBS some years ago. The two filmmakers portrayed the women's movement in the 1970s, the effort to get the courts to catch up to changes in the way people were living, the effort to get legislation. And these filmmakers, Betsy West and Julie Cohn, did a fantastic job, and it was well-rounded. It included all the familiar figures, even clips of someone who is no longer in this world, Betty Friedan, and Bella Abzug and Gloria Steinem. But it also portrayed the people who were anti the Equal Rights Amendment, Phyllis Schlafly, among them. And I admired that film, and when the two makers, Betsy West and Julie Cohn, came to me and said that they would like to do a film about me, I said, okay. And so they followed me around for 2 years, where if I went to have a conversation like this, if I made a speech at a bar association or law school, they came with me to the Santa Fe Opera. In that film, you will see scenes. It's a scene from Lucia de Lammermoor, and they did a fantastic job of arranging and editing reams of footage that they had about me. They also filmed an opera, a real opera, at the Kennedy Center. It was Daughter of the Regiment, and I was not simply a super, an extra. I actually had a part. I was the Duchess of Krakentop, a very haughty woman. I had the opportunity to write my own lines. Very few operas have speaking parts. Sadly for me, I'm a monotone, so I can't be in an opera where my voice will be heard.
Well, that was one of the nice parts of the film, and the movie on the whole is a really wonderful telling of your whole life. Of course, many of us knew a lot of that already, but even the movie still illuminated many things, some of which I'll get to in a minute. But when people mention the movie, there's one thing they mention repeatedly about the movie, and that is your workout regimen. There are some great photos of, or shots of you in the movie pumping iron and doing planks with your trainer. So how often do you exercise?
Twice a week. Bryant Johnson, who is the author of the RBG workout, he and I spend an hour together. We use the Justice's gym, and we do it at an hour where the place is mine, that most people have left the building. It's from 7 to 8, and we watch the news hour during it. Now, I started with Brian in 1999. And it began because that was the year I had my bout with colorectal cancer. And when I was finished with the surgery, with the chemotherapy, with the radiation, I was not in very good shape. And my husband said, "You look like a survivor of a concentration camp. You must do something to build yourself up." So I started with Bryant in 1999, and he is with me. I saw him most recently yesterday. Yeah.
Well, I will say that I, of course, remember some of that period because I was working in your chambers then, and it should be noted that you never missed a single day on the bench during that entire period.
Yeah, I had the year that you were with me was the year after. Mm-hmm. And the surgery, but I was still having some difficulty.
So now you're many years past that, and so I'm just going to ask you, for the record, to the best of your knowledge, is there any justice on the court who can do more push-ups than you?
There may be two candidates. It may be Justice Gorsuch, who rides a bicycle from Potomac, Maryland, where he lives, to the court and back every day. He's in good shape. And I think our chief is also a possibility.
So the documentary, which is really wonderful, is not the last we're going to see of you on the big screen. There's a biopic that's coming out, I think, in December of this year called On the Basis of Sex, with the British actress Felicity Jones playing you. And so when she was asked why she wanted to play you in this role, her answer was she wanted to play a female genius. That's what she said. Can you tell us a little bit about that movie, and have you been involved in the project?
My nephew, who is a script writer, asked me if he could do a film about a particular case in which my husband and I were co-counsel in 1971. It was a case that went to the 10th Circuit. And I asked him, why did you pick that case? Because it ended at the 10th Circuit. We prevailed. The government sought review, and review was denied. So my nephew, Daniel's answer was, I wanted this film to be as much the story of a marriage as it is the story of the development of a legal strategy. Mm-hmm. And I think the director succeeded in that, mm-hmm, in that mission. It will open on Christmas Day. Supposed to be a very popular day for going to the movies.
All right, you heard it here.
Well,
um,
I should say that there is an excellent actor playing Marty, is Armie Hammer. And this is something you would appreciate, Goodwin. There's a scene in the kitchen, and Marty is Marty in Armie Hammer's portrayal is chopping vegetables, and he the hand motion, he had it down exactly right. In fact, during the filming, Armie made a dinner for the cast.
Oh, wow.
And he made it out of Marty's recipe book. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a book in the Supreme Court gift shop called Supreme Chef. and that was Marty, my excellent husband and chef.
So that's one of the most touching parts of the documentary and this movie and your whole life story. You met Marty during your first year of college at Cornell. You've said that he was the first boy you ever dated who cared you had a brain. The two of you had two wonderful kids, Jane and James, and a two-career marriage at the time, two lawyers, in fact, which was unusual. Can you describe that early period and what kind of social pressures you faced with respect to marriage, family, life, career?
In those ancient days, I went to Cornell University. There were four men to every woman. So for parents of girls, it was the ideal place. Because if you couldn't find a man at Cornell, you were hopeless. And then when I get to Harvard Law School, I'm one of nine women in an entering class of over 500. That was an improvement over my husband's class. He was 1 year ahead of me. There were five women in that class. Harvard Law School didn't begin to accept women until 1950. And I got there in 1956. I don't consider my daughter, now a distinguished professor at Columbia Law School, any kind of a problem for me. In fact, I attribute my success in law school to Jane, because the babysitter came at 8 and left at 4. So I would go to school, study very hard, and wasted no time, come home at 4 o'clock, and then it was Jane's time. We could go to the park, we'd play silly games, till she went to sleep, and then it was back to the books. But each part of my life was a respite from the other. There was study hard, and then play with a little child. So, I mean, the hard time for me was when I tried to get a job. I was engaged by a well-known firm as a summer associate. And I thought that I did a pretty good job. But there was no offer. One reason was that they had not too long before I came, engaged a woman named Polly Murray. You'll be hearing more about her. There's a documentary about Polly in the works. But Polly was what was then called a twofer. That is, she was both African-American and female. So the firm didn't need to show how avant-garde they were. They had Polly, and they didn't need another. And when I told that story, a member of that firm said, of course we made an offer to you. You preferred a clerkship. And then I said, check the records. So how did I do with clerkships? Well, I was tied for first in my class at Columbia, so I had top grades. And my mother-in-law had gotten a neat, well-tailored black suit for me to wear to my interviews. I thought I looked very lawyer-like. But no judge was interested. I had some help. And the help came from Jerry Gunther, who was teaching at Columbia at the time I was there and was in charge of getting clerkships for students. Jerry later went to Stanford, where he remained for the rest of his life. But he was bound and determined to find a judge who would take me. I think he called every Second Circuit judge, every district judge, and one, Judge Edmund L. Palmieri, offered me a job. Years later, Jerry wrote about it, and he said, this is how I got Ruth a clerkship. I asked Judge Palmieri, because I knew he was devoted to Columbia. He was a Columbia College graduate and a Columbia Law School graduate, and took his clerks from Columbia. So Jerry said, give her a chance, and if she doesn't work out, there's a young man going to work for a downtown firm. He's very good, and he will take over. So that was the carrot. And then there was a stick. And the stick was, if you don't give her a chance, I will never recommend another Columbia student to you. For the women of my era, the first job was powerfully hard. But once you got that first job, the woman generally performed at least as well as the man. So the second job wasn't a problem. And that was not a problem for me. But getting your foot in that door was very hard. I mean, I said I'd had three strikes against me. One, I am Jewish, and the big firms in New York were just opening up to Jewish lawyers. Then I was a woman. Most firms wanted no women. This was pre-Title VII days, so there was no law against discrimination. The employers were up just up front saying they didn't want any lady lawyers in their shop. The absolute killer was Jane, because if they would take a chance on a woman, they would not take a chance on a mother of a young child.
And yet you persisted, of course, and overcome many of these barriers, and this is a great tie-in to the theme of our program today, diversity in the legal profession, and thank you for everything you just told us, which contains so many great lessons there about mentoring and how we promote people and go to bat for people. And I'll just say that fortunately, the world has changed a bit for the better since your legal career began. That's been due in part to your own accomplishments as an advocate and also a judge. One of the most important decisions you've written was the VMI decision, which opened the doors of the Virginia Military Institute to women. And one of the most poignant scenes, I think, at least for me, in watching the documentary, is when you visited VMI for the first time in February last year, 21 years after the decision, which was not greeted with universal enthusiasm at VMI at the time. So can you describe that visit?
The general in charge of VMI is so proud of the women cadets. They have the same Spartan living quarters as the men, and in the first year they go through the rat line. I met with these women. Many of them wanted to be engineers. In my days at Cornell University, which had fine engineering colleges, there was only one woman enrolled in engineering. There were dozens at VMI. The school, it realizes what a good thing the admission of women was for them, because it enabled them to upgrade their applicant pool. It's a real success story. There were women on the faculty now, even on the board of VMI. So it was a very happy occasion. In the beginning, it was rocky. VMI said, all right, we'll take these women, but they're going to be treated just like the men, which means when they come in, they get their head shaved. So now they have made an accommodation. The women do not have to shave their heads. But the general assured me that that was it. There was no other difference. I looked at the young cadets, I looked at the general and said, do you allow male cadets to wear earrings? He was taken aback. After a pause, he said, not on campus.
So the VMI decision was 7-1, with Justice Scalia dissenting and Justice Thomas recused. But the 7 included your Chief Justice at the time, William Rehnquist, which was surprising to some, because I think it's safe to say that no one calls him a feminist icon. How did you get his vote?
It was not hard. The old chief is a good example of, as long as one lives, one can learn. You know, in the 70s, when Rehnquist was the junior justice, I could count on him to be a dissenter from all the cases in which I was successful. But then there was Goodwin, I don't remember what year it was, but when Miranda was up, the Miranda warnings. Mm-hmm. The old chief had criticized that decision many times. When it came to, will we overrule it? Mm-hmm. He said no, and he wrote the opinion saying no. And in that opinion, he explained that the Miranda warnings had become part of the culture. It was in movies, it was on television. And the police found it not a real barrier. In fact, it was helpful to them. They gave the warnings, and then if the arrestee chose to speak, mm-hmm. and they were home free. More startling than that was the old chief wrote the opinion of upholding the Family Medical Leave Act. Mm-hmm. And I took the opinion home to show Marty. He said, Ruth, did you write that?
Wow.
So, as I said, as one lives, one can learn. And Justice Thomas was recused because his son had attended VMI. So Justice Scalia was the lone dissenter, and what he predicted about the school's downfall is the opposite of what happened.
So as a result of that decision and many others that you helped bring about, we have a jurisprudence of equal citizenship of men and women. We have civil rights laws that are designed to promote equality of opportunity. So as you reflect now on all of those accomplishments, what do you think are the biggest barriers today to equality?
There's two. And one is what has been called unconscious bias. The example I give whenever this question arises is the symphony orchestra. When I was growing up, I never saw a woman in a symphony orchestra, with one possible exception, maybe the harpist, but that was it. Critics thought they could tell the difference between the sound a woman makes on a violin, a piano, and a man. Someone decided, let's put Howard Taubman, the New York Times critic, to the test. Let's blindfold him and see if he can tell. And they had a series of pianists play, and Taubman was all mixed up. It was a man, but he said, oh, that's a woman. And he owned up to that. He saw a woman and he had a low expectation. He didn't see her, and she came out much better. Now, we can't duplicate the drop curtain in every business and profession. There is a case from the, I think it was 1978, which is also an apt illustration. And it was a complaint by women against AT&T for discriminating against women in promotions to middle management jobs. The women, it was revealed, did as well as men, the men at least as well, on all the criteria up to the very last. What was the very last? It was called the total person test. And the total person test was the interviewer speaking to the candidate for promotion. At that last step, women dropped out disproportionately. Why? When the interviewer is facing someone who looks like the interviewer has a comfort level. He knows what this person is like, but if he is interviewing someone who's different could be a woman, could be a member of a minority group, there's a certain discomfort that he feels. He's not quite sure what this person is. And that discomfort is reflected in his preferring the white male to a woman or a member of a minority group. This is not a case of deliberate discrimination, but it's that unconscious bias that it is operating. I think that's still with us. The more people recognize that it exists, the more likely it will be that the biases will be overcome. And also, when women and members of minority groups are there in numbers rather than as one at a time curiosities, that barrier will fall. The other principal impediment, I would say, is what has been called the work-life balance. Can a lawyer have a satisfying job and also time to help raise the children, care for the home, cook dinners? I had thought that in this electronic age, flexible schedules for people would be much easier to arrange. And because you have the whole law library at your fingertips at home, it's better than it once was, but there's still a rigidity. I knew early on that life at law firms did not have to be arranged that way. They did not have to be sweatshops. I knew that because Marty was head of the tax department at a notorious sweatshop, Wild Natural and Menzies. But if you went to that firm in the evening and looked for a tax lawyer after 7 o'clock, you wouldn't find one. And Marty set the model. If you went to the bankruptcy department, even at midnight, you'd find someone. Same for antitrust. But the work, it can be arranged so that there's time for family. I remember in this town, Washington, D.C., when the first woman was appointed a part-time partner. Her name is Brooksley Bourne. She was working for Arnold and Porter. When she had her second child, she asked if she could have a part-time schedule, I think 3 days a week. And she was told, yes, we're glad to keep you on board. You've done such a good job. But if you will be part-time, forget about becoming a partner. Well, some years later, she became the first part-time partner. So I know that balance can be achieved.
Could I suggest another issue that has been very current in our times? Have you followed at all the Me Too movement, and what significance or impact do you think that has had on the conversation?
I think it has had a huge impact. I met one of the women who started Me Too. She told me that she had told her story to the New York Times 2 years before they published it. The attitude at first was, boys will be boys, forget it. But now we know that that's not so anymore. Well, Me Too, the idea is, if you have been abused, come along. There are many of us. There's strength in numbers. And my hope is that it will not be just Hollywood stars, but it will be housekeepers at hotels, for example, waitresses in restaurants. Yes, it was something that was hidden far too long. And I'm very glad that it has come out in the open.
Thank you. So the judiciary has also changed a bit. I myself sit on a 7-member court. We have a chief justice who's a woman. We have a court that was a majority women court until we had a recent vacancy. But there's still a ways to go. The federal judiciary ratio of men to women is about the same as it is on your court, which is about 2-1. What do you think would be different if there were, say, 4 or 5 women on the U.S. Supreme Court? And will we ever see that?
When will there be enough women on the court? My stock answer is, when there are 9, of course. But I'd like the younger people in this audience to know how that third was achieved. Jimmy Carter gets credit for that. when he became president, he looked around at the federal judiciary and he noticed they all looked like him. They were all white men. He was determined to change that, to appoint women and members of minority groups in numbers. He appointed 11 women to courts of appeals, over 25 to district courts. And I was one of the lucky 11 that went when I was appointed to the D.C. Circuit. But he changed the face of the U.S. judiciary. And at the end of his term, it was October 1980, he had a reception for the women he had appointed. And the guest of honor was Shirley Hofstadter, who would have been his pick for the Supreme Court if there were a vacancy. Mm-hmm. And he said that even though he didn't have a Supreme Court place to fill, he hoped he would be remembered for making the judiciary look more like the great United States. And once the old way was stopped, it wasn't restarted. President Reagan didn't want to be outdone by his predecessor, so he was determined to appoint the first woman to the Supreme Court, and that was Sandra Day O'Connor. One third it is not enough, but think of the way it was. When I was in law school, there was only one woman on a federal court of appeals. She was the first woman ever appointed to a federal court of appeals. Florence Allen, nominated by Roosevelt in 1934, I think. And she retired in 1959, the year I graduated from law school. Then there were none again until 68, when Johnson appointed Shirley Hofstadter to the Ninth Circuit. In my early days on the D.C. Circuit, I had the great good fortune to meet and talk to the first woman ever appointed to a federal district judgeship, and that was Bernita Shelton Matthews, appointed in 1948 by Truman. She was in her 90s when I got to the court. And it was just such a great experience for me to speak to this woman who described what it was like in the really bad old days. Yeah. One of her stories was she would go to the White House when there was a demonstration, hold up her sign, votes for women, not say a word if she was hassled by the police, because she didn't want to risk having a record, an arrest record, that might impede her admission to the bar. She was going to law school at night. She told me she hired only women as clerks because her colleagues hired no women. And she thought that she had the best clerks at the court. So it's moving in the right direction, not as fast as we would like it to. But three is certainly better than one. When I was the lone woman after Justice O'Connor left, the wrong image was portrayed. People who come to visit the court, the students who are on the 10-minute line walking in and out. So they saw eight rather well-fed men and one little woman. But now, as you can see from that fine photograph, we are all over the bench. Now, I've been there so long, so this term I will sit next to the chief. And Justice Kagan will be some seats down on one side, and Justice Sotomayor on the other. So the appearance is these people are part of the court, and it's natural, it's right and proper that there should be women there.
Thank you. That helps put in perspective some of the numbers and reminds us just how recently things were different and how they've changed. Turning a bit to your cases, so a lot of observers have described your approach to judging as incrementalist. At your confirmation hearing 25 years ago, you said, and I'm going to quote you, "My approach is neither liberal nor conservative. Rather, it is rooted in the place of the judiciary, judges, in our democratic society." And you've often spoken out against judicial activism. In an early article, you wrote that Roe versus Wade may have gone too far too fast at a time when the political process was moving in favor of abortion rights. And then the Chief Justice Roberts, quoted that commentary on Roe in the Obergefell decision in his dissent in 2015, saying the court should have let the democratic process play out longer. I guess I have a specific question and a more general question. The specific one is, why did you think it was the right time for the court to decide that issue when it was presented in Obergefell? And the broader question is, have your views about gradualism changed at all in the course of your tenure on the court?
There's one big difference between the chief's use of my words in Obergefell and my what I have said about Roe, because it's 100% clear that I would have voted for the judgment in that case. But it was an extreme opinion in this sense. The Texas law was easy to put down. It was the most restrictive in the nation. There was only one ground for a woman to have access to an abortion, one ground, and that ground is the procedure is necessary to save the woman's life. Nothing else. It didn't matter whether the pregnancy would leave her sorely disabled. Doesn't matter if the pregnancy was the product of a rape. Only one reason. So the court could have said that extreme law is unconstitutional. Instead, the court wrote an opinion that made every abortion regulation in the country, even in the most liberal state, in one fell swoop, and you know, a good one, that's not the way courts traditionally behave. They deal with the case that's in front of them. Mm-hmm. They take one step at a time. My fear about the decision, I think, has been borne out. One effect, the winners said, we have it all. The court has done it all. We can go home and relax. The losers built up strength and a strategy. They had a single target now that they could aim at. Instead of dispersing their energy fighting in the trenches state by state, there was this one target that they could identify and say, see that activist court, those unelected jurists, so I think that the opinion would have gone down much better if it had dealt just with the law, the law involved in Roe, the Texas law. And then there would be another case and another case. Mm-hmm. But after Roe, the history has been that the court has upheld many restrictions, not all, there have been a few that the court did not accept. So you asked, would I do anything different?
Why do you think Obergefell, the same-sex marriage decision, was different then? What was different about the nature of that issue when it came to the court?
Oh. It was the you could see the Obergefell case. You could see it on the horizon when gay people came out of the closet, said, this is who I am and I am proud of it. And then people looked around. Who were they? They were us. They were our next door neighbor, our child's best friend, maybe our child. So one of the problems with race discrimination is that we still have highly segregated living. So from that, a we-they mentality can emerge. This is us and this is them. But when gay people came out and didn't try to disguise who they were, it wasn't we, they, because they were we. They were in our family, in our neighborhood. So I think courts generally lag behind social change. In Obergefell, the lag wasn't too long, but it was not the court that started it. It was people in numbers saying, we are entitled to have our Are human rights respected? And then the court reinforced the social change that had already occurred in society.
I want to ask you about some dissents. So first, let's start with Saturday Night Live. They have a skit about you on their weekend update in which Kate McKinnon plays you as a sassy judge who's dishing out one-liners and then dancing after each one and saying, "You've been Ginsburned." So my first question is, did you teach Kate McKinnon the Ginsburg dance?
No, but my son sends emails, things that he thinks I should see, and that Saturday Night Live is one, and Steve Colbert, when he had his own show, is another. But I think she's a very good comedian.
Well, you've certainly written a number of very memorable dissents in the Affordable Care Act case, the Hobby Lobby case on contraceptive coverage, the Lilly Ledbetter case, of course, on pay discrimination, the Walmart case, last term Epic Systems. One dissent you've spoken about is Shelby County, on voting rights, where you had the nice phrase that throwing out the preclearance requirements of the Voting Rights Act when it has worked and is working to stop discrimination is like throwing away your umbrella in a rainstorm because you are not getting wet. Can you say a few words about this decision, what it meant to you, what it means to voting rights in this country?
That was major legislation, the 65 Voting Rights Act, renewed periodically with huge majorities on both sides, Republican and Democrat. The court's view was that under the Voting Rights Act, under Section 5, if you have in the past discriminated against, made barriers for minority voting, then any new voting law that you want to enact, you have to pre-clear either with the Justice Department or a three-judge court in the District of Columbia. That pre-clearance system was working quite well. And when the court held that it was out of date, and there was no pre-clearance anymore, many municipality states went back to the way it once was. So in Shelby County, I pointed out, you couldn't expect Congress to come up with a new set of districts. What member of the House, what member of the Senate would stand up and say, "My county discriminates, so please put us down." There was a mechanism in the Voting Rights Act to get out from under the preclearance system, and that was if your record was clean for X number of years, you could bail out. And that was the check that Congress put in. And we have seen restrictions that never would have achieved free clearance come right back again. So that was my point. Section 5 was working. It should not have been tampered with. But that's a good illustration, good one, of why it would be wrong to label me a, quote, activist judge. I suppose if activism means readiness to strike down legislation, I think I would be among the least active judges. Mm-hmm. And I would get high marks for respecting the legislative process and products.
So, looking ahead a little bit, last week we saw the Senate hold confirmation hearings for a nominee to your court. Many observers have said that the process today looks nothing like your confirmation hearing 25 years ago. President Clinton nominated you in June of 1993, and you were confirmed by the Senate 2 months later by a vote of 96-3. I might add that the National Asian Pacific American Bar Association was pleased to support your nomination. How would you compare the process that you went through with what's going on today in that process?
The way it was right. The way it is wrong. The atmosphere in 93 was truly bipartisan. The vote on my confirmation was 96-3. Even though I had spent about 10 years of my life litigating cases under the auspices of the ACLU board, ACLU, and I was on the ACLU board and one of their general counsel. My White House handlers asked me questions about my ACLU affiliation. They were very nervous about it. And I said, forget it, just forget it. There's nothing you can do that would lead me to badmouth the ACLU. And not a single question. No senator asked me any question about that. It was the same for Justice Breyer, who was nominated a year later. He had in the 90s the numbers. Or think of Justice Scalia, who is certainly a known character in what was it, 1986? He had been a law professor and written many things. He had been on the D.C. Circuit. The vote was unanimous. Every Democrat and every Republican voted for him. But that's the way it should be, instead of what it's become, which is a highly partisan show. the Republicans move in lockstep, so do the Democrats. I wish I could wave a magic wand and have it go back to the way it was.
So I want to thank the audience for some of the questions that I've gotten on note cards. The justice was kind enough to take some pre-screened questions.
Not by me.
I'll just give you a few. They'll be easy ones. Do you use a smartphone? And what apps do you like to use if you use a smartphone?
Yes, I do have. Oh, yes, and I do have a favorite app, and it's I don't know if it has a name, but it's sleep. When I traveled, I carried a noise machine, which I turned on, and I'd fall asleep instantly. And if I didn't have my noise machine, then I was restless. So I was in Zurich, and my noise machine broke. And the police officer from the court who was with me said, "You can get any noise you want on your iPad or your iPhone." And that's quite true, so I don't need any. So that, I would say, that is my favorite app.
Good. How did you first get the nickname Notorious, RBG?
It was launched by a second-year student at NYU Law School. And she invented the Notorious RBG just after the Shelby County decision came out. She was distressed by the decision, even angry. And then she decided, well, what good does that do for me to be wringing my hands or say bad things about the court? I should do something positive. So she put up my dissent on Tumblr, and then it just took off into wild blue yonder. You mentioned a number of the items you can get. One is a room freshener, and the people who sell that product that sent me a sample in bubblegum flavor.
Have I ever told you, Justice, that I have a nickname too? You know the actress Jennifer Lopez? She goes by J-Lo.
Yeah.
My Chief Justice calls me J-Lou.
Oh.
What do you read for pleasure?
And my choices are eclectic. And I do have a favorite mystery writer. Her name is Donna Leone. And I recommend her to you highly. I went to Rome this summer, so I have a book called Mistress of the Vatican that I'm about in the middle of now. And there are many, many books on the shelf that I'd like to read if there were time.
Understood. So we're almost out of time, but I have a couple just very last questions. So as you mentioned, you arrived at the court in 1993 as the second woman ever to serve on the Supreme Court. Your colleague, Sandra Day O'Connor, was appointed by President Reagan 12 years earlier in 1981. So as you think back to your first days on the court and what you've learned since then, are there things that you do differently now compared to when you were first appointed?
I use the computer a little more than I did when you worked for me. I don't remember, Goodwin, whether when you were with me, I adopted Justice O'Connor's practice of whatever draft a law clerk completed would be circulated to the co-clerks. So she would have the benefit of the best thinking of her entire chamber's crew. So I adopted that somewhere along the way. Goodwin was with me the year of Bush v. Gore. So that was a very tense time, as you remember.
I forgot about that case completely.
Well, for all of us, it was a marathon because the court granted review on Saturday, briefs were filed on Sunday, oral argument Monday, decision Tuesday. And there were four separate dissents because there simply wasn't time for the dissenters to get together and agree on one statement. Well, that was an extraordinary episode. What else do I do? I think basically the pattern is the same. You remember the law clerk's manual? Mm-hmm. With the current law clerks, it's one of their duties to keep it up to date.
Let me pose a question. A good concluding question, I think, from an audience member. We have lots of students here. When you reflect on your life and in all of its dimensions, and your judicial career, of course, what advice would you have given to your 24-year-old self?
Do you mind?
To yourself when you were 24 years old, what advice would you have given to yourself?
What I have given to myself? Mm-hmm. When I was 24 years old, I had been married for 3 years. I don't know that this is advice, but I think it's to have a life partner that you love and you hold each other up is tremendously important. And I was blessed many times over in that way. The other is I think I mentioned this in connection with Shanna, the student who started the notorious RBG. Don't give way to emotions that drain your energy and do you no good. Like anger, like jealousy. Be patient. If things don't work out the way you want the first time, then you try and you try again to get it right. And very important, I think, in being a lawyer or a judge, working in a collegial setting, very important is to have a sense of humor.
Well, thank you. I think our time is almost up. And before I turn it back to Pankit for some concluding remarks, I just want to say to you, on behalf of everybody here, how proud we are of all that you've accomplished in your career. You're not only one of the most respected people in this country, but also one of the most admired, and that is not the same thing. So thank you for being such an inspiration to all of us, and we're so grateful that you could share some of your time with us this evening. So thank you.
Thank you for an inspiring and insightful discussion, RBG and JLU. As long as you live, you can learn. Very wise words said by Justice Ginsburg. We will carry these lessons with us as we move forward in our careers. Thank you again to GW Law for hosting NAPABA for this wonderful discussion, and thank you all for joining us. Have a good night.
Ladies and gentlemen, this concludes the conversation between Justice Ginsburg and Justice Liu. Thank you for joining us. Those of you with an additional ticket, please remain in your seats while the rest of the audience exits.
Here's a look at our primetime lineup tonight on the C-SPAN network.